and this is my tops and bottoms for August. I had a really weird August and I have been putting off making this video for too many days now. Normally, we start these tops and bottoms videos with my top books. We start on a high and then we finish on an occasional meh. Today we're gonna do it the other way around because this month has been wholly tainted by one book. So here we go. My one bottom book for the month was my highest anticipated new release for this year, and it is Pieces of Her by Karen Slaughter. I'm gonna give you a moment to compose yourselves because I know that you, like me, will be experiencing a sense of general shock at this point that I have read a Karen Slaughter book and I have not got along with it. Recovered? Good, because I'm not. I am still tremendously salty about this book. So essentially, Pieces of Heart is about a mother-daughter relationship. It is about Andy, who is 31, she's drifting in her life, she's fallen into a career as a police dispatcher, but just doesn't really care. She's living with her mum again because she moved home to help her mum when she was dealing with breast cancer. And although that crisis has passed a few years ago, she still hasn't moved out or made any kind of future plan. Then it is about Andy's mum, Laura, and she really wants to see Andy thrive. She wants to see her get her wings under her and do something that makes her life meaningful. And one day they have gone for a perfectly normal lunch after Andy's shift, and a shooter walks into the cafe that they are in and opens fire. And the whole crux of this book, what the whole thing hinges on, is that one interaction. Andy runs and Laura stands up to the gunman. I will start with the things that I liked about this book, because despite the fact that I now want to set it on fire, it wasn't all bad. In fact, in the beginning it was great. The first third of this novel is exactly what I described to you. It is the narrative of Andy unfolding her mother's past. But this novel is then written in a back and forth in time narrative. We then go back to 1986 and we follow a cast of seemingly, at the beginning, unrelated characters. And not only were they all unlikable people, but they were all incredibly two-dimensional, and that's where everything fell apart for me. So I didn't believe any of the characters that were in the second part of the narrative. And the second part of the narrative takes you to an economics conference in, I believe, Geneva, where there is a almost political plot. And suddenly, I've been transported from this very relatable narrative about Andy and her mother to literally a treatise on economics. And this is what I think went wrong. And when I've spoken to a lot of people now about this book, because a lot of people knew I was picking up and so were following my updates on Goodreads. And when I hit the part where we went back in time and I was like, okay, I'm gonna admit I'm really struggling with this one now, I literally got a slew of people who went, oh thank God, I'm hating it, I wanted to talk to somebody about it, I don't understand what's gone wrong. And the thing that I think has gone wrong boils down to there is too much plot and not enough character. Karen Slaughter has committed the sin of thrillers where she has done so much research into economics and cults and radical groups and some of the other stuff that I can't tell you about, but there's another heavily researched portion in this book. She's done so much research and she's plotted the plot out so intricately that she's left no room for the characters to breathe, and she's also left no room for those characters to blossom and change the plot. They have no agency over what's happening to them. It very much feels like everything that's happening is happening to them. And I couldn't get behind that because it is such a 180. It is such a quintessentially different philosophy from all of Karen Slaughter's other novels, which are heavily character focused. And it feels like the plot, the things that are happening are only happening because the characters are making decisions. And in this one, it felt like the characters didn't need to make any decisions, that the plot was all predetermined and they were just kind of acting it out. Also didn't help that I found the characters in the past almost wholly deplorable. And when I say that, I don't say that as somebody who reads a lot of books where she feels like she has to like all of the characters. I have read a slew of books in my life, things like The Secret History by Donna Tartt, which is a masterful work of manipulation, and none of those characters, not a single one of them, is relatable or likeable in any way, but it was wonderful to read how despicable they were to each other. These characters are just assholes. So if I hadn't been buddy reading this, I probably wouldn't have finished it. I'm going to be perfectly honest. I probably would have DNF'd it. So, on to the books that I really, really loved this month, because as I said, there were three. They are all very, very different types of reads, but I am in love with all of them. The first one, just in chronological order, is The Nowhere Girls by Amy Reid, and holy crap balls, I was not expecting this book. This is honestly a book that I think should be required reading for life. So this one is about three very different high school girls who essentially come together to subvert the rape culture in their high school. They send out a group email to all of the girls in their school, and they ask them to meet to discuss the way that the men, the boys at their school, treat them. And what happens is something off the charts, is a movement that these girls realise is much bigger than them. And I just, even talking about this book makes me feel so passionate about what they did. There is never once in any of the girls' experiences in this book, not just our three main characters, but in the slew of other girls who are talked about, and other boys in some cases, there is never once where an opinion is not taken as valid, even if that opinion is not the opinion of the majority. Even when girls are saying, but why shouldn't boys be allowed to do that? Their opinion is still listened to, their thoughts are still valid. Every report of rape or sexual assault or molestation that happens in this book is received with open ears and open arms, and everybody is believed. The girls create this amazing culture of, you can say these things out loud. You do not just have to whisper about them in bathrooms. You don't just have to tell each other when you're drunk and you are letting it fall out. You can say these things out loud and we will listen to you. The sheer breadth of representation in this book, it's impossible for me to explain how casually it's included and how normalised it is made, and I so appreciate that for a YA book, because I feel like sometimes YA literature, the author has a tick sheet of all of the things that they're including that are diverse, and by doing that it kind of singles them out rather than normalises them and makes them part of what we see in our everyday. The three girls in this book make me feel so mama bear. I think I finally understand what it must be like to have children, because I am so protective over them and so proud of what they achieved. And just, this book is amazing. Just read it. Like, really, you should just read it. The next top that I have for this month is very much less serious and is genuinely one of the funniest, the most compelling thrillers I have ever read in my life, and it is Sweet Pea by CJ Scoose. This will most definitely be on my top 10 list for 2018. It's impossible for it not to be. This one is about Rhiannon, and Rhiannon is your typical girl next door. She works a sort of semi-interesting job at a local newspaper. She lives with her builder boyfriend Craig. She has a little dog named Tink, who she loves. Oh, and also she's a serial killer. Yep, you heard me right. She is a serial killer. This novel is written in diary entries by Rhiannon, and at the beginning of every diary entry we have a kill list, which is a numbered list of all the people who have pissed Rhiannon off. And in the beginning, this list is quite funny because it includes things like Dylan on the checkout in Lidl, acne wallet chain who bangs my apples and is never happy to help. So at the beginning, it's impossible to tell whether the inclusions on Rhiannon's list are people that she's seriously intending to kill, or whether they're just people like in our everyday who have really annoyed us and who we just can't let go of at that particular moment. And then, very quickly, and I mean very quickly in this book, a thing happens and you realise that although Rhiannon thinks this is all quite amusing, she is deadly freaking serious. Deadly being the operative word. This book is so irreverent and so funny, but so terrifyingly relatable. It's a little bit like if Bridget Jones was a serial killer. And it was delightful, because at the same time that I was going, yeah, all of those things annoy me, yeah, I hate that person, I was going, oh, you are incredibly screwed up. And that's what I love about this novel, is despite the fact that it's so funny and so irreverent, we get a really deep discussion on nature nurture in this novel. Rhiannon had a really, really, really screwed up childhood. And at several times, she's talking about something completely unrelated, and then she'll drop in a line and you'll be like, wait, what happened to you? And her unfolding of how screwed up she is and how deeply affected she was by her childhood, it is just, it's masterful. I was so shocked by how hooked I was. I turned pages so quickly. I honestly would have read this book in a day if I had had the time, and it's like 400 pages long. It had so many twists, it had so many turns. Every time you thought you knew what was going on, something else happened. I guessed nothing. And at the end, there is the biggest, most cliffhangery twist where you're like, no, I need more now. And luckily there is more. There is a sequel called In Bloom. Do not look at the cover. Do not look at the cover. Do not look the book up before you have read this one, because the cover, the actual cover of the book, has a printed spoiler on it. Do not look at it. Read this first. And the last book that I have for my tops for August is a non-fiction true crime book that I fell in love with. I genuinely did read it in an afternoon because I just could not put it down. And it is The 57 Bus by Dashka Slater. The back of this book very cleverly doesn't give very much away about the plot. And I love the way that it's done it, because all it says is that it's about Sasha, who is a teen who is sleeping on the bus on the way home from school. And it is about Richard, who is a teen who is skipping school with some friends, and in a moment of very misplaced comedy and very definite bullying, Richard flicks a lighter against Sasha's skirt and sets them on fire. And the fallout from that one incident in 2013 has continued to impact Sasha and Richard's life to the present day. But then you get into the meat of what this book is actually about, and it is not just about a horrendous stranger crime perpetrated on a bus. It's not just about a crime between two teenagers. It is also a discussion of gender and sexuality and romantic inclination and what it is like for black and underprivileged youths, especially in a town where the majority of people are quite privileged. What we swiftly discover is that Sasha identifies as agender and uses they, them pronouns. And Sasha decided this very early on in their life. And we go back to the point where that realization happened. Dashka Slater has interviewed Sasha's friends and family, and of course Sasha themselves, and has pieced together these little interludes that made Sasha who they are. And in this first section, we also have four pages completely devoted to the differences between gender, sexuality, and romantic inclination, and all of the common terms therein. And then we have a list of the terms that Sasha chose for themselves. and it was so mind-blowingly open and informative. I learned things from this book that I didn't know, and I consider myself to be quite well informed when it comes to gender differences. The second section of this book then introduces us to Richard, who is an extremely underprivileged black kid who goes to the second choice high school in Auckland and who has literally watched three of his best friends die one after the other. He is at a point where he's on academic probation. He is slowly slipping into the streets and into the kind of world that he's only looked at from a distance and said, that's never going to be me. And then the two sections come together in a third where we see this horrific incident unfold. The discussion about what the court decides to do with Richard and how Richard and his friends and family and Sasha's friends and family all come together as a result of this incident made me so super emotional. I think the book is especially effective because it's written in little sections like this, and each section focuses on something a little bit different, which builds to an overall narrative. There's some poetry in there from both the author and from the individuals concerned, but there's also pages of statistics. There are pages of information such as the gender and sexuality and, you know, various pronouns and labelling stuff, but there's also pages with interviews from the people involved in Richard's life, which just makes me so incredibly sad. It is not an easy book to read. If you have found anything that I have said triggering or difficult to listen to, then you're probably not going to make it through. But I think that if you even vaguely think this is something that you would enjoy, that you need to try it out because it is amazing. The discrimination that both of these kids have faced have shaped them in really different ways, and what they choose to do with it at the end of this book is pretty mind-blowing. So, those are my three amazing tops and my one very, very significant bottom for the month. As always, please tell me whether you have read any of these books or whether you're planning to pick them up now after hearing me talk about them. I cannot recommend any of these three more highly. Can't believe that I had three 5-star reads in one month. It was such a good month in all aspects that had nothing to do with this. Also tell me what you thought of this in the comments, and we can either commiserate or I can congratulate you that you enjoyed it and it didn't ruin your month the way that it almost ruined mine. And I will speak to you soon, guys. Bye!